So for the first time in 6 years today, somebody came in here and complained about the music. So clearly it's time to quit. Move somewhere else. It's 5 minutes a day, dude. Chill out. All right.
Did they actually mention like previous days?
No. Maybe if you guys all scream really loud, I'll come in here again. All right. Anyway, we're disturbing the geology department. You know, the rocks don't make a lot of noise. But apparently they don't like rock music. Jokes are. Jokes go on and on. Okay, so let's have class. Today, let's make my laser pointer work. All right, quick assignment one checkpoint. You should be almost done at this point. The deadline is Friday at 5. Remember, there's no late credit for this. Get what you can out of the 50 points and move on. Assignment two is, the first part of assignment two is to do a week later. So there's just no time to like realize that you should have started 2 weeks ago, right? All right. Anyway, you've seen this before. That's where we are. So we have office hours today, tomorrow, Friday. Please come in and get help if you need it. Also, please, how many people have submitted something to test 161? Or at least run the verify step to make sure things are set up okay? Okay, do that. You gotta do that. We're not gonna accept late submissions because you couldn't get things set up properly. That's on you to do. Okay. So today we're going to talk about locks and spin locks and other simple synchronization primitives. Hopefully you guys have some comfort level with these now because you've been using them. We'll go through an example that's new to you that you haven't had to solve before. And at some point, maybe on Friday, we'll discuss a little bit about choosing the right primitive. Now again, this is something you guys are gaining some experience with. So both the stoplight and the whale mating problem can be solved using several primitives. But if you've already finished one of those problems and you're kind of bored and you don't know what to do for the next couple days, try solving it with a different primitive. Try going back, redoing it. I mean, save your code, create a branch or something in Git so you don't lose the solution you have. But try doing it with something else and see how it works. Usually what you'll find is that there's one primitive that works really well and leads to a clean solution that's very satisfying. And there's another one that just starts to get gross and you feel sad and unhappy about. So it's not always true. Sometimes there's several primitives that can work well in a particular situation, but usually there's a good choice. All right, so at the end of last class, we started to talk about critical section. So a critical section is something that we use to bring some control to this wild world of concurrency that we've created. And the idea of a critical section is only one thread can be executed inside the critical section at a time. And on uniprocessor systems, it was possible to implement a critical section by just making sure that the thread that was inside the critical section didn't stop running until it left. And the reason for that is because there's no other cores on the system, nothing else can be happening, ergo, nobody else is running inside the critical section. But that solution is clearly broken on almost every interesting computer today, because every interesting computer today has at least two cores, if not more. Well, I shouldn't say that. I mean, I guess if you're interested in Arduinos, but there's probably like, isn't there like a multi-core Arduino? Yep. Okay, there you go. Well, okay, fine. Any interesting computer has at least two cores. So, this is just sort of a historical interest. I'm not going to talk about this. We're a little bit behind. So in general, what we need is we need a mechanism so that other threads will stop before they get inside the critical section and wait in some way or another. And we'll talk about two different ways that we can get threads to wait, both of which are familiar to you. Has anyone looked carefully at the code for the spin lock that we gave you? Obviously, that's a working primitive. You're just so incurious. Come on, read the code. It's so interesting. So I would encourage you to do this. The spin locks we gave you work, obviously, but you might want to get a sense of how they're implemented. Achieving synchronization on multi-core systems requires some type of hardware assist in most cases. Usually the hardware itself is going to provide you some help. It's actually kind of interesting. The MIPS instruction set that your compiler toolchain generates and that Sys161 supports is, at this point in time, a very strange amalgam of old features that were part of the MIPS R3000, which is what was, I'm sorry. You guys are like getting nervous up here. I'm gonna like walk into your lap. Okay, I'm gonna move this over so I have more room to wander around. So at this point, that instruction set is the mixture of old stuff that was from the R3000 era, and then a couple of new instructions that David added that are designed to support synchronization. Those instructions did not exist in the MIPS R3000 instruction set. Why not? What's that? Yeah, that was like on the 80s. There just wasn't a problem they needed to solve. And so you have this like very vintage instruction set that has a couple of special instructions that have been just ported in from the future in order to make the system work on multiple cores. And the idea here is that these special hardware instructions give a little bit of a boost to the software that's using them and make it easier to write the low-level primitives that provide atomicity across multiple cores. Think about it, I've got one thread of one core that's running, and suddenly it needs to communicate something with the threads on the other cores. Doing this safely and doing this efficiently can require a little bit of hardware help, so that's what we do. There's a couple of varieties of these. There's probably new varieties that are out there today. There's something called a test and set. So when I'm talking about instructions now, I'm talking about processor instructions. These are part of the architectural instruction set. These are not like C things. And if you look at the code for Spinlocks, I think at some point there's some inline assembly there where David is actually using the new atomic instructions that he introduced into the MIPS R3000 variant that OS-161 supports. So test and set works by it writes a value into a particular memory location and returns the old value. Now, the reason that these instructions are special is that they're guaranteed to work across multiple cores. So if let's say that there's a memory location, and the value of the memory location is 0 when I start, and at the same time, 4 cores hit it with the test and set, and the value that they're setting is 1. So what should happen? 4 cores, existing memory location holds value 0. I try to test and set it to 1. What should happen? Yeah? Exactly. One of them and only one. Now, which one? It doesn't matter. Right? It's one of the 4 that's doing something at the same time gets back 0, the previous value, and sets it to 1. And then all 3 of the other ones get back a 1. So you can start to see how this is something that I can use to implement other synchronization primitives. All right. Yeah, so this is just pseudo C code for this operation. Also something called compare and swap. Same thing, a little bit different. Compare the contents of a memory location to a value that's passed in. If they're the same, then set it to a new value. And here's some C-like code. So I give you a comparison. So I could say, if it's 0, set it to 1. And so if it's 1, it won't be set, right? Because it didn't meet the first condition. Again, keep in mind, this is atomic with respect to other cores that are trying to execute the same hardware instruction. So if 4 of these happen at the same time, you can work out what should go wrong. One person will get the old value back, and everybody else will get a new value. Or the compare and swap will fail. Okay, and so this is a cute variant of it that uses 2 instructions. This is something called load link store conditional. Load link returns the value of a memory address, and then later on, I have this store operation that will succeed only if that memory address hasn't been changed since I did the first load link. So again, these are just examples, and you don't have to understand all these perfectly. Test and set is by far the easiest one to understand because it's the simplest. But the other ones lend themselves to different programming paradigms that may make it a little bit easier to implement the things that we want. All right? This is actually, now I remember, this is here because this is what this is what System 161 uses. This is what the MIPS R3000 architecture supports. So this is code from OS-161 somewhere. Has anyone ever included inline assembly code in their C code before? Ah, there we go. You can do it. Here it is. Here's one of the possible syntaxes. And here, these are the 2 instructions here that are actually doing the work. So this is the load link, and this is the store conditional. All right, any questions about these underlying hardware primitives? Yeah?
So, we did four of those attributes for could you speed this is MIPS, right?
Yeah.
So, the syntax doesn't look the same. Is there any difference between?
You guys did this for what?
Three, four, one.
341? I have no idea.
It's like a basic instruction set, and there's an extended instruction set. I think we're only allowed to use the basics when we're using this.
Okay. But keep in mind, this instruction is from the future, right? These were introduced. So at some point, like 3 or 4 years ago, David said, I want to add multi-core support to OS 161 because I want you guys to be able to do assignments with multiple cores, which is really cool. Again, that MIPS, as far as I understand, the basic MIPS R3000 instructions that didn't really have support for these instructions. And so David sort of had free rein to modify Sys161 to support the instruction he wanted to use. And this is the one he chose, or the combination of it, right? So my point being simply, I have no idea if this has any basis in the official MIPS R3000 instruction set or whatever it was based on, because that instruction set was not necessarily multi-core friendly. OK. So a lot of processors provide some variant of one of these instructions. And what we do is we use that as a starting point to build simple synchronization primitives, and then we can use them to build more complicated synchronization primitives. And on other equivalents, you can use this using other atomic hardware instructions. So essentially, if you have one of these, you can implement some of the others. So if I have a test instead, I can use that to create an atomic compare and swap. OK, so going back to the bank example that we had before, let's try to use a bare test instead. Now, this is never what you would actually do, because remember, the goal of these atomic hardware instructions is to use them to build synchronization libraries on top of. So you would never use these instructions on their own, unless this was sort of a special case. But let's try to modify our example to use a test and set. So remember, test and set tests the value of returns the old value of a variable, sets it to a new value. Okay. So remember, what three lines of the critical section here that I'm trying to establish? What three lines of code represent the critical section? So the first three. And you could think of this being the part of the code where the balance is inconsistent. My local copy of the balance is inconsistent with the global copy. Once I've synchronized the two, I'm done. But those three lines of code are the place where I'm making a modification that I can't get interrupted in the middle of. And so what I can do is I can add a test and set at the top. I set it to 1 so that other threads know that I'm inside the critical section. And then at the bottom, I'm going to set it to 0 so that other threads know that I'm finished. Does this work?
Why not do a test and set on the value itself? No,
I'm just using the value as a flag, right? You can think of the value here as a Boolean indicating whether or not there's a thread inside this critical section. So does this correctly mark whether or not there's a thread inside the critical section? Yeah, sets it to 1 and then clears it. That's fine. What does it not do?
Checking whether or not.
Yeah, if two threads come in here, the second one's just going to blow right past the test and set and keep going. Right? So I need some way to wait at the top. How would I do that using a test and set? It's possible.
While not done.
Yeah, so I can do this. If test and set is equal to 1. So what does that mean? If the test and set returns 1, someone's inside the critical section. So what do I need to do? Wait. Do I have any useful way to wait here? Yeah. So what I essentially end up having to do here is write a while loop that repeatedly tests the condition until it returns 0. And remember, the hardware is helping me here. So the hardware is guaranteeing that, you know, the point is that that while loop will return as soon as somebody else sets it to 0. Now, when I'm busy waiting, it doesn't matter as much, because even if the two interleaved a little bit differently, I'd be OK. But in other cases, it's important, particularly when I'm waiting using sleep. So this will work. What's wrong with it? OK, yeah. So. There's a couple problems that are wrong with it. What's the first thing that could happen here, right? What's wrong with that top loop? What is it accomplishing? Yeah, it's doing nothing, right? So what you would have here is something like this, right? Now there's two cases here, right? I don't know. don't know, whatever. It's a meme. Who cares? Heath Ledger. He was very good. He was good at that role. So this is, the problems with approaching waste cycles, okay? Now there's two cases here. In one case, it's like really bad, although it will probably still work. And then the other case, it's just marginally bad. So what's the really, really bad case here? Remember, the processor, the operating system is swapping threads back and forth between a smaller number of processors to create the illusion of concurrency. So what's the worst thing that can happen here? Yeah?
Process sets it to 1, and then maybe that process dies for some reason, so it just stays at 1.
Well, yeah, that's terrible, right? Yeah. So that's a really great point. And this is really, really true when you guys are doing, like, look, if a thread crashes in your kernel, it's going to panic, right? That's probably what's going to happen. But so on some level, if the kernel is panicking and rebooting, who cares if there's a lock that's held, right? It won't be held when I reboot. But you're right. Whenever you use synchronization primitives in real code, you have to be very careful to make sure that you handle errors inside of them properly so that the lock doesn't get stuck, right? That's a good point. Dan, what's something else? That's a good point, yeah. If my like bi-weekly deposit gets held up by all the Amazon purchases I'm making, right, then at some point I'm gonna have a problem, right? Yeah. But yeah, so let's assume that this is fair, right? Let's assume that once I'm in line and I start waiting, there's no real rhyme or reason to who gets the lock next. Yeah.
It keeps switching between the processes that are in the while loop and go back.
Yeah, imagine I have one core. Okay? Or imagine for some reason all the threads that are running this code are running on one core. So one thread gets into that loop at the top. What is it waiting for? It's waiting for some other thread to run and drop the lock, get out of the way so it can get in. But if it's sitting there on that core, what's not happening? That other thread's not running, right? So I am actively impeding the thing that I'm waiting for. I'm waiting for something. And I'm making that thing take longer, right? Bad, OK? So that's the worst case, where for some reason, either I only have one core, which again, I told you never happens, which is true, or for some reason, this thread. Now, in general, this thread is in the way. The longer I'm waiting, useful work's not getting done. Now, there is one case in which this is OK. So what am I hope is going to happen? Let's say I have two cores. When I get into this while one loop, what do I hope is happening? The other core is running the thread that's inside the critical section. So if I'm spinning on thread on CPU 1 and CPU 2 is running this other thread, then he's still making progress. Sorry, I always use male pronouns when I'm referring to threads, right? Just think about that because they're dumb. They just do one thing at a time, and they run sequentially until they die, right? So that's why I use male pronouns for the threads, OK? So the thread is running on the other core, and it's just going to run until it dies, right? Until it finishes, and then the other thread's going to make progress. So that's what I hope is happening, right? Has anyone run into this on their when doing their OS/161 code? You may have gotten a error message about spinlocks, deadlock on a spinlock. So the spinlock implementation we gave you actually enforces the fact that if the spinlock is held by core 0 and another thread on that core tries to acquire it, it'll panic. And you know, it's not necessarily in every case a bug. I could just spin on that core until the OS decided to run something else, and then it would make progress. But the semantics of spinlocks are that you're not supposed to hold them for very long. And so if I'm sleeping, if I get descheduled, then that ends up being a problem. OK. So problems with this approach: busy waiting, I'm wasting cycles, and I can actually slow down the threads that are trying to do the thing that I'm waiting for. This is not good. All right. We've gotten to the point. I mean, you guys have been using locks, right? And the real reason to use locks as a synchronization primitive is when you can associate them with one or multiple critical sections. The typical use of a lock is to guard some piece of shared state so that the people that are accessing that shared state, the threads that are accessing that shared state, can do so safely. It's pretty much the primary purpose of a lock. Now, I don't want to confuse you. It's possible to have multiple critical sections that are associated with the same structure. Let's say I have some sort of shared data structure. I might have one method that adds an item to it. I might have another method that withdraws an item from it. I might have a method that looks up an item. Imagine like the implementation of a Python dictionary, for example. Right? That has to be implemented. There's actual code that implements that. I know it's magic, right? But like when you do like dictionary whatever, there's actual C code or C++ probably that has to run to implement that. And it has to work synchronous. It probably has some locking that it does to make sure that this works okay. Because there's operations that it's doing on this structure that need to all be done together so that the structure's state doesn't get corrupted. The way you use the lock, pretty simple. You guys have started to do this. Acquire it when I enter the critical section, drop it behind. Now, what we've described today is something called a spin lock. And the idea here is that there's two ways to wait. Way one is I wait actively by continually checking the condition that I'm waiting for. The other way is passively, where I go to sleep and I have an arrangement with the thread that's using the resource or inside the critical section that as soon as it's done, it's going to wake me up. So those are my two options. So it's a spin lock. Normally, spin locks are not used on their own to solve synchronization problems. Now, it's possible, actually, in some later assignments, that you may want to use spin locks in a few places, and we'll talk about why. Well, by the time we're done, hopefully I'll give you a little bit of a guide about when to use spin locks and when to use a traditional sleeping lock that you guys have implemented. All right? But they're commonly used. I mean, you have seen them used now in both the semaphores and your lock implementation as a way of building more complicated synchronization primitives. All right. But let's go back and let's solve this in a different way. So now let's create this lock object. And what happens if I call lock acquire while another thread is inside the critical section? It has to wait somehow, right? So I have to wait. And if I wait actively, I'm spinning. If I wait passively, I'm sleeping. OK, so I think I've said a lot of this. So I can wait actively by continuing to hold the CPU and continuing to check this condition over and over again. So this is busy waiting or active waiting. Or I can have some sort of semantics where I arrange to sleep, get out of the way, let the other thread that's inside the critical section make progress, and it then needs to be able to wake me up when it's finished so that I have my chance to go through the critical section myself. Now, there are some cases where spinning is actually the right approach. So let's think about it. Why would I never want to spin on a single core system? We just talked about this. Because I'm slowing down the thing I'm waiting for. On a single core system, there is no way that spinning can ever be useful. Because whatever's inside the critical section needs to run. It needs to do work. And if I'm using the CPU, then it can't. So this is never the right thing to do on a single core system. If the critical section is short, and if I'm completely 100% certain that I'm not going to sleep, so for example, if the critical section involves doing something like I/O, where my thread is going to have to wait for some really slow hardware device like a disk to do some stuff, then by definition, the critical section is not short anymore. It's really long. So the critical section being short means I cannot do any sleeping. Now, we haven't talked about context switches yet, because we sort of swap things around a little bit and we're doing synchronization first. But when we talk about threading, there is work that is required to stop. Remember, the operating system is producing this illusion of concurrency by rapidly shuffling threads back and forth onto the CPU and off the CPU. That is not done magically. There is work that has to be done. I have to do some housekeeping every time I move a thread onto the CPU or move a thread off of the CPU. And so if the critical section is short, so here's an example. Let's say that CPU, you know, this is an example of two threads running on two different CPUs. For some reason, they're both called thread one that are waiting for a resource. So thread one acquired the resource first. It's inside the critical section. CPU two ran a thread that tried to acquire that resource and decided to sleep. So it said, OK, I'm going to go to sleep. And what happens is that thread stops running, and there's all this work I have to do to save the state of that thread so that I can restart it safely again. And in the meantime, thread one's done, right? I mean, in this case, imagine the critical section is only a couple of instructions. So by the time CPU 2 wakes up, the amount of work that I had to do to put it to sleep and wake it up again is actually larger than the amount of work it would have had to do to just wait actively for a couple more cycles. Does this make sense? So in one case, I'm wasting cycles by waiting actively. In the other case, I'm wasting cycles by going to sleep and being woken up again, because these are not free operations. And so if the critical section is really short, then on average, I actually win by waiting actively, because I waste less CPU cycles. I also get the resource faster, right? If I had waited actively, I would have had the resource right here. But by the time I get to sleep and wake up again, all this time has gone by. Conversely, if the critical section is long, involves lots of operations, could ever potentially involve going to sleep, waiting for I/O, waiting for some sort of slow resource, then it's always better to use a sleep lock. So here's an example, again, sort of the converse of the other one. I have a long critical section. The thread on CPU 2 is waiting actively. And in this case, at some point, and it doesn't have to be very long, it becomes better to go to sleep, yield the CPU, let somebody else do useful work, and then arrange for the first thread to wake me up later. And again, this is always true whenever there's any sleeping involved. And that's why there are those checks in your current system, so that if you hold a spin lock and do something that goes to sleep or calls yield, the next attempt to grab that spin lock will panic. Questions about this at this point? I like this. I feel like you guys understand all this stuff. I actually don't even have to give these lectures. I may not be physically able to continue giving these lectures if I can run into that thing. All right. Okay. What you guys have seen and what you guys have implemented is pretty common functionality, particularly the wait channel. So the notion of a wait channel is pretty powerful. And you guys may not understand how general purpose it is. The wait channels that you guys are using are not used just in the context of the locks and the condition variables that you're using them for. They're used all over the place in the kernel. And the idea is pretty simple. Essentially, it allows a thread to wait and give the system an identifier. That identifier is typically like a memory address that has some special significance. So for example, it could be the memory address of the lock structure that I'm waiting for. If I was waiting on I/O, it could be the memory address of the I/O queue that the operating system is using internally or something like this. It's just a name, but of course it's a machine name, so it's in hex and it has lots of ones and zeros in it. And this essentially allows me to wait for something to happen, where that something is, you know, denomified. Is that a word? I'm trying to use words that are outside my comfort zone now. So anyway, that is named by some sort of key. And then later I can wake up one or multiple threads that were waiting on that when something happens. And you can imagine, again, that this is a very general purpose primitive. It allows me to wake up and put to sleep threads that are waiting on locks, condition variables, I/O. You guys will use this later when you do assignment 3 to wait for particular memory copies to be done to various parts of memory so that a process can restart, whatever. But this is the basic operation of a wait channel. And I just want to point out, a lot of this stuff, actually this is true for all of these things. So has anyone ever used these primitives in user space? No one has ever used a lock in a user program? Anyway, we need better systems courses. So you can do all this in user space. I just want to make sure that people understand these are not, this is stuff that we're teaching you because you're going to need it in your kernel, but this is something that you can use when you implement like a web server. This is something you can use when you implement any piece of multi-threaded code. Every good piece of software today, every good programming language and every good sort of framework has these types of functions, right? If you program in Python, there are Python locks, mutexes, condition variables. If you program in Go, there are the equivalent. Sometimes the names are a little bit different. Go calls locks mutexes. There are different terminology, but the functionality is essentially the same. Same with waiting. So all this stuff I can do at user level as well and use it to manage user level concurrency. We're just happening to be using it to manage kernel level concurrency in this particular class. All right, questions about locks? Yeah. Yeah, so the wait channel happens to be implemented in a FIFO queue, I think, currently in OS 161. That's not guaranteed by the interface, so that's very important. And this is a good example of the hazards of making assumptions about how things work. So if you look at the wait channel interface, all wake one says is it wakes up one thread. It does not say which thread it wakes up. It doesn't say the thread that was waiting the longest or whatever. It just says it wakes up a thread. So if I went and changed the wake one implementation to wake up a random thread, your code had better still work. Now, I will make a sad admission here, which is that our solution for reader-writer locks violates that interface contract. So we make assumptions about the lower-level code. And I did that, and I'm OK with that. I'm a grown-up now, and I can make these sort of trade-offs. But it would break if I changed the implementation of wake one. But that's a good point. If the interface doesn't say something specifically, users of the interface are not supposed to assume it. Right? It makes it possible for the underlying implementation of the interface to change. Right? It's a good question. Yeah?
Can the priority of a thread tell if it should spin or sleep?
Well, keep in mind, spin locks and sleep locks. Well, I guess that's true. I mean, I guess I can implement a lock that allows me to wait for it either through spinning or through sleeping, right? Whether or not I would use that to do prioritization, I don't know, right? Not necessarily. Let me see where I am on time, because I want to mention. OK, we'll come back to that when we talk about scheduling priorities. Yeah, other questions? Yeah?
We use a spin lock inside a sleep lock, right?
Yep. That's a good question. So why is it safe to use spin locks inside the semaphores, inside your locks? Yeah.
The wait channel makes the spin lock be unlocked.
Well, OK, so the wait channel is going to unlock the spin lock before you go to sleep, right? But again, come back to the critical section arguments, right? There is a critical section inside of your lock implementation, OK? There's a set of things that have to happen atomically. Specifically, there's a condition you have to check, and then you have to go to sleep. If you don't hold a spin lock there, you can try this. I mean, if you're done with your locks, do the following. That spin lock that you're grabbing, move it inside of the check, right? Now, the wait channel will break if you don't hold the spin lock before you call the wait channel, but it's easy to fix that, right? Just instead of grabbing the spin lock, checking the condition, and then going to sleep, check the condition, then grab the spin lock and go to sleep. And what you'll find is there's a race condition there, right? And so that spin lock is creating a very small critical section inside your lock. And the fact that it's small is what's important. And obviously, if you can't implement a sleep lock without needing another sleep lock, you're in trouble, right? Like I'm going to call myself recursively, and it would just be bad, right? So yeah, so this is an example of how we're using a spin lock to build these higher level problems. Yeah, question. Yes. Yeah, that's true. It's busy waiting on the way to getting onto a sleep queue potentially. Yeah. Yeah, but absolutely. There's a little. You're right. There can be a little bit of busy waiting in the process of checking the condition that determines whether or not I can acquire a lock or not. Right. So remember, I'm busy waiting to make sure that the condition doesn't change between when I check it and go to sleep, right? So if one thread grabs a lock and then goes off and computes 100,000 digits of pi, the other threads that try to acquire that lock will do a small amount of busy waiting, and then they'll be on the wait queue, right? But you're right. That's a great point. It does require a little bit of busy waiting to get onto that wait queue, right? Yeah. Other questions? Yeah.
Why can't we guarantee the first in, first out work in more wait channel? All it does is when we put a thread to sleep, it just puts it in the thread stack. So basically, when we are making it out, so it should work in FIFO. Why does it?
No, okay, so let me make a distinction here. And this is important for you guys to understand as programmers, and something that we should have taught you 4 years ago, okay? When you guys use other pieces of code, right? So when you guys are implementing your synchronization primitives, you're using the wait channel, okay? We gave you the weight channel. Now look, if you want to, it's your code. You can make the weight channel do this, right? You can say that part of the weight channel interface is that it is going to use a FIFO queue. But the description of the interface that you're using does not say anything else other about does not say anything about wake one other than it wakes up one thread. So it gives you no guarantees. In a more normal case, you're using an external library that somebody else wrote, right? And so you have two options. You can take that library and you can make it your own and start maintaining it and make it do exactly what you want. But that's usually not what you want to do. You want them to maintain the library because that's what they're doing. That's how you collaborate on things. But if the library maintainer says it wakes up one thread, and you're assuming that it wakes up threads in FIFO order, then someday you may start failing all of your tests, right? Because the library maintainer decided it was more efficient to store the threads in like a heap or something like that, and it stopped behaving the same way, right? So this is not about the fact that we can't guarantee that the threads come out in FIFO order. The interface doesn't guarantee it, right? But this is really important to understand. When you guys read interface descriptions, if the interface says X, that's it. That's all you get. Actually, just as a side anecdote, so when people, are you guys, I always have to ask this question now, are you guys old enough to remember back when Microsoft was getting in all this trouble for antitrust violations? You guys maybe were in diapers, I guess. Okay, some of you are old enough. Yeah, so at some point, people were like, and it's kind of funny now because Microsoft seems like a little behind the times now, but back then people were like really scared, Microsoft's dominating the market, and one of the things people were concerned about was this idea that if you use Windows, if you use the Windows API, you don't have access to the source code. So you call some part of the Windows API, and you don't know how it's implemented. Except if you're, so let's say you're building Internet Explorer. Let's say you're building Chrome, right? So you get this big book that's like that thick that says Windows API documentation, okay? And then you read it, and it says, okay, this function does this. But the problem with the Windows API is after 20, 30 years, it's got like 18 functions that do any one thing you want to do. Okay? So it's like read a file. Okay, take your pick off the menu. There's 15 different functions that do that in slightly different ways. So if you're Chrome, you scratch your head a little bit. You're like, okay, I'm going to pick that one. Hopefully it works, right? If you work on Internet Explorer, you pick up the phone, and you call the guy who maintains that code. And you're like, which is the fastest? Like, which is the best? Which is the one that you're going to keep maintaining? Which is the one that's going to disappear in the next version of Windows? And he's like, oh, yeah, I'll check that out for you, and whatever. So this was one of the concerns people had about collusion between Microsoft writing software and Microsoft writing their operating system, was that the operating system, the software that Microsoft wrote, could make assumptions about the way that the operating system worked that other people couldn't. And you can imagine it going even further. The guy who's developing Internet Explorer might be like, it would be great if there was this system call that did X, right? Why don't I call up the guy who works on the team and be like, by the way, it would be really helpful to us. It would really improve our performance if you would do this one thing. Oh, okay, you know. Where if you're at Chrome, you're like, no way, you know. Just you don't have that opportunity. So this was one of the concerns back in the day about this sort of collusion, was that Microsoft understood the internals of their interface. Everybody else had to try to use the interfaces written and wasn't able to make these sort of assumptions about it. So, interesting historical artifact.
How come Internet Explorer sucks so much then?
That's another question. I don't know how to answer that question. You would have think with all the advantages they had, right? It's like, ah. But this is the thing. I mean, it was like, anyway, like, imagine how bad it could have been, right? If they couldn't have made all those assumptions. Anyway, OK. Let's, yeah. Well, it's still alive, I guess. Do people still use Internet Explorer? Other than my father, who I've been begging for years, please stop. I will migrate all of your bookmarks to Chrome, and then you can stop calling me every day because your internet's slow. All right, let's forge onward today. Okay, locks are designed to protect critical sections. It really is the number one reason to use a lock. And if you think about the lock semantics that you guys, of the locks you guys have designed, you'll see this. Locks are not a communication or a signaling mechanism. They're a correctness mechanism. They're designed to make sure that a bunch of things can access one piece of shared state and do so safely. And that's really, and they are good at that. That's what they're for, right? That's their core purpose. They are not good for other things. Now, to some degree, lock release is kind of a signal, because what lock release is doing is signaling the other threads that are waiting that they can come in now. Right? But this is a very, very limited form of signal. OK, so let's talk about other types of conditions that threads that are working together on a problem might want to notify each other about. And we're going to do this buffer example. So for example, I might have one thread that puts data into a buffer for another thread to process. And the first thread wants a way to notify the other thread that there's data waiting for it. Okay? This happens a lot, right? It happens a lot in programs that you guys use, where there are multiple threads working together to do things. You know, one thread takes the input from the mouse click, figures out where you clicked, adjusts some state, and then calls some other thread to re-render the UI or something like that. Your child is exited. You know, how do I notify a process that one of the sub-processes that created has exited? So in contrast to locks, which are really entirely a correctness primitive, condition variables are a signaling mechanism. Condition variables are allowed to let threads signal each other when certain things happen and wait for things. Probably the most confusing thing about condition variables is the variable part, right? Well, maybe it's both parts, actually, condition and variable, because there's no condition or variable in the condition variables, right? You guys, how many people implemented condition variables who were sort of confused? Like, that's it? That's all I had to do, right? Like, where's the condition? Where is the variable, right? Where are the condition and the variable? Outside the condition variable. Yeah, so condition variables are usually used as part of some conditional expression, frequently inside a while loop, and with some global variable that multiple threads are accessing. And the condition variable you could think of as a way of one thread notifying other threads. Speaking of noise, jeez, I should go yell at that person. Geology department's moving rocks around again. Okay, so you can think of the condition variable as allowing one thread to notify other threads about interesting changes to the variable, right? There's some change to the variable that I want to alert other threads to because it's going to cause them to do something interesting. And this condition usually represents some change to shared state, right? A condition out of, you know, a variable has changed, and some condition that you're waiting for may have changed as well. All right, how much time do we have left? Oh, 5 minutes, this is awesome. Don't start putting your stuff away. You guys are sending me these signals like it's time to stop. I'm not done. All right, so condition variables can convey information about the world. And it's the more information, but it's really any information, right? All locks allow me to tell All locks allow threads to do is tell each other that they're done using a critical section. That's it. Condition variable, the information that I convey can be a lot richer. All right, so let's go through an example with a shared buffer. This is sort of a classic condition variable example. You can find code for this online, whatever. So here's what I want to do. I have a buffer that stores information, some sort of object, and I have a producer that puts things into the buffer, and I have a consumer that takes things out of the buffer. All right? Why would I want to do this? This seems dumb. Why not just let the producer thread like process the data itself? Why would I ever use a queue like this? Could anyone come up with like a realistic example? Again, it does seem dumb, right? Did I concoct this just for the purposes of this example so that we could use a condition variable? Give me an example where it might make sense to do this sort of separation of work.
Pipes.
Yeah, okay, that's not bad. Yeah, pipes, like I want the first process to keep doing what it's doing. Right? I don't want to have to wait. What else?
E-commerce
site. Well, any sort of website, right? So frequently on websites, when you guys click something or click submit, there's all sorts of stuff that has to happen. Like when you buy things on Amazon, when you hit buy now, it's not like it completes the whole transaction while you're sitting there, right? It could spin until the package arrived on your doorstep. It's like, oh, it's delivered, right? No, clearly, I mean, obviously there's parts of the latency I want to hide and there's parts I don't care. But the point is, I want to do just enough work so that I kind of know that things are kind of okay, and then I want to redraw things, I want to redraw the display and finish the transaction. In the background, there's transaction processing going on, there's emails that get generated, blah, 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 right? And those can be done in the background by separate threads, So the thread that's actually rendering the UI can return and give you useful information. This is like a common way of reducing the latency of an interactive application by farming stuff out to background tasks, right? I get a background task to send the email so that I can return immediately and show you a nice confirmation page. OK. So you might think, why are condition variables a synchronization mechanism? So just may talk about this, and I think we'll start with this example on Friday. One of the things that's really important when I use CV signal, CV wait, and CV broadcast is making sure that the condition doesn't change between the time that I notify other threads and the time that the threads check the condition. So this is very similar to the interior of the lock that we talked about before, where there can be a small race. So if I check that the buffer is full and the buffer is still full and then I go to sleep, but I don't guard that carefully, I can end up sleeping despite the fact that there is space in the buffer. And for this reason, condition variables of the type that we use, well, actually, this is exactly this example, right? So if I don't guard this buffer state carefully, if the other thread gets switched in, put some things in the buffer, I'm already on my way to the sleep queue. And so now I have a condition I don't want, which is I have a consumer that's sleeping despite the fact that there's data in the buffer. And so for this reason, I use condition variables with a lock. I don't know how this got in here. Oh, maybe I took that example. All right, so let's stop here. On Friday, we'll do the producer-consumer buffer example, and we'll talk about deadlock. I'll see you then. Good luck with assignment 1.